Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is entitled Biblical Missionaries. Last week and this week, we're looking specifically at the experience of Paul. And this week, we have Paul, his mission, and his message. This is lesson number 12 for September 19 of 2015. While you're thinking about the mission and message of Paul, and hope you have your Bible handy, let's bow our heads and ask God to guide us as we study. Our wonderful Father, we bow before you now, asking your guidance, the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Open our minds, help us to comprehend what is in this lesson for us, and what we can learn from the experiences of Paul, what we can learn that might be appropriate for us in our day, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It's hard to imagine someone better qualified to be a champion for Christianity than Paul. I mean, look at his Greco-Roman background. He's a Roman citizen. He's had a background in Pharisaic Judaism, and then he comes to Christianity. So he puts together, in the New Testament as we have it, his 13 books he wrote, what we might call a salvation history. And basically what he did is he said, here's an Old Testament, and this Old Testament has in it a lot of things that look forward to the coming of Messiah, and that Messiah is Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And he lived and he died for every one of you. Whether you're a Gentile, whether you're a Jew, it didn't matter. He lived and died for you. And in that context, he said, and let me distinguish for you very distinctly the difference between the traditional Jewish cultural ideas and beliefs and rituals carrying ons versus what's truly biblical. And that upset a lot of people. And so I would ask you right up front, do you think you could correctly distinguish between the necessary components of the gospel and the culturally determined civil, ritual, and moral practices of the Jewish life? You have lots of help from Paul. Well, what we see in the life of Paul is, we'll go through this lesson, what we see in the life of Paul, he was concerned not only with just converting people and just adding their names to the church books, which we sometimes seem to be focused on now. He was concerned with every detail. He said he cried tears over churches and so forth, and especially we think of the experience with Corinth and so forth. Every detail of his members' lives, he did his best to try to help them see things from a Christian perspective. Foremost in his concerns was the teachings about Jesus and him crucified. You know that passage, 1 Corinthians 2, verse 2. For while I was with you, I made up my mind to forget everything except Jesus Christ and especially his death on the cross. What do you think he specifically had in mind?
Paul talked a lot about, dying with Jesus. When Jesus died, we die with Jesus. So then later on when we, because I think you have to die to live. Mm-hmm. And I think that's partly why he focused a lot on the Jesus and him crucified. Because without the crucifixion, there really is no life. There's no salvation. There's no life. Mm-hmm. So I think we should look at it as a very
well,
good
we know
gift.
That Paul's message, he carried it from Jerusalem to Antioch, Tarsus, and all the way over, possibly as far as Spain. We don't know for sure exactly where he went during those couple of years after he got out of Roman prison. He established well-founded churches in at least four major provinces of the Roman Empire. That's amazing. So, here we have the challenge. Jesus was crucified as what? For what reason? Why was he crucified technically?
He was a traitor.
He was crucified as a traitor to the Roman government. So now you're in Rome, let's say, and you're trying to convince Romans that they should become Christians, and you should believe on someone who's been crucified as a traitor to the Roman government. And they said, yeah, hooray, that sounds like a good idea, right?
Well, there were stories that he preached before the high leadership, and they were pretty intrigued with what he was saying.
And he managed to actually convince people from Caesar's household. Mm-hmm. What did he say to them that convinced them? What would you do? Was it the fact that he claimed at least that someone had risen from the dead?
Well, it had to be something that they could possibly believe.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you think? If it was something else, they would just think he would be crazy. They wouldn't even listen to him. It was the idea of what was happening that intrigued them.
Yeah, Paul says, what he says specifically is Jews demand miracles and Gentiles or Greeks want logic. What do you think that meant?
Well, you have to put it in context.
Sure.
The story he's saying adds up and makes sense to them.
Yeah, okay.
The Greeks and Romans, they had artists. They argued things out.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The Jews were used to having prophets from down through
perform
the ages.
Miracles, yeah. Yeah. Well, what do you think it would take to convince a Roman that Jesus was no longer in the grave? Or a Greek?
I think Paul was well equipped to give him a quick history lesson of what had happened and its effect on him, and how he knew others that had witnessed the fact that Christ had risen and they'd seen him go up into heaven.
Okay, I'm gonna use all of you here now as an example. Someone shows up, let's say I show up here, and I say, guess what? Let's put ourselves back in the first century, okay? You know this Jesus. He was crucified. He rose on the 3 days later, went back to heaven, but I just saw him. And you would say what to me?
It would take your medicine.
Yeah, the sun too long.
I mean, you know.
Well, we're kind of judging them as scientists like we are now these days. Back then, there was a lot more spiritual ideas, whether they were all cockamamie or not. I mean, people would talk about it, and they would talk about them honestly and with seriousness, mm-hmm. you know, where it's a little different today. If you get into the spiritual part, people start calling you crazy all real quick. But
let's look at least one of the predictions of Jesus' coming. Deuteronomy 18:15. Moses himself is giving his final sermons to the children of Israel before he climbs Mount Nebo and dies. Let me just back up a little bit here. Then Moses said, in the land you're about to occupy, people follow the advice of those who practice divination and look for omens. But the Lord your God does not allow you to do this. Instead, he will send you a prophet like me from among your own people, and you are to obey him. Isn't that a pretty clear prophecy?
Mm-hmm. That could be applied to a lot of things. Even Paul.
I'm asking, would you convince people, could you convince people that that applied to Jesus Christ?
To get back to this and what you were saying earlier, if you came to this group and said you had seen that, I think it comes down to the individual. You can just write it off, or you can say, okay, explain to me how this happened. Mm-hmm. And if the person's willing to think outside the box, mm-hmm. is willing to have their paradigm shift a little bit, and you tell the story from beginning to end, and you can gather the picture of Christ, it can make that first stunning argument that started the conversation seem very reasonable.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So,
now, when he said Jews expect miracles, what do you think he was talking about?
Crossing the Red Sea.
Yeah. They said, look, Moses said to us, a prophet like me. What did Moses do for the children of Israel?
Struck the rock, got water for them.
Well, not only that, he got them out of slavery, right? Yeah. Okay, if you are like Moses, you're going to get us out of what?
Under the Romans.
Get rid of the Romans, right? That's what they wanted to see, right? So, how do you think most of the Jews were impacted by the miracles that Jesus did? And what would you, if you were Paul, we're talking about Paul now, what would you say to people about the miracles? We know quite a few miracles that Jesus did. What would you say to people about those miracles?
Well, there was an awful lot of the first century Jews that were impressed by it and were the first Christians, so.
Well, if you had been cured from leprosy, for example, you would be impressed by it, wouldn't you?
Raised from the dead, mm-hmm. or had somebody you knew was raised from the dead.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you look at this man who performed miracles, he feeds thousands, he does all this kind of stuff, and Paul probably quoted individual people, say, Sister so-and-so was there, she ate the food. Mr. So-and-so was there, he saw Jesus raise Lazarus from the dead. And so forth. You know, I don't know. I'm just guessing. He would probably cite specific cases like that. And we know that for the Jews, Paul would start with the history of the Old Testament, so try to show how these things pointed forward to the life and death of Jesus. I wish we had all the details of one of his sermons.
Is it possible that the what took place in Jerusalem with Pilate and all the Romans there, and even the ones that were guarding the tomb? The events that happened with those Romans, did that make it back to Rome, those stories?
It's very possible.
Already kind of an idea?
Yeah.
Well, it was the Passover. There was a lot of Jews that came from all over the place and were on the wall and watched the whole thing. Is this the man that everybody's talking about that did all the miracles?
Okay. Now, we're doing a little speculating here. Who were the people that guarded the tomb, Jesus' tomb?
Romans. Were they not Roman soldiers?
Roman soldiers. How many of them?
Two.
How many Roman soldiers were guarding Jesus' tomb?
About 100. Is it?
100! There was a centurion there with 100 Roman soldiers.
Yeah. There's a lot of them.
Okay. What happened to them? Do you remember what Ellen White says? They, of course, saw the angel come down. They fell like dead men. They then saw Jesus appear, come out of the grave, and disappear. And what happened next?
They were bribed.
By whom?
By the temple.
They were bribed by the Sadducees particularly to keep quiet. Do you think they kept quiet when they got back to Rome?
Well, it depends how serious it is to let somebody steal the body. From the grave when they're guarding it.
Well, no, I don't think they would. There would be any stealing the body kind of thing. I think they would tell the truth of exactly what happened.
Kind of beyond stealing the body, it was resurrection.
Well, I know that, but what I'm saying is that if a person gets bribed, and they say that somebody stole the body. Well, that's kind of backwards too, because they would be in trouble for that.
Mm-hmm.
They let it happen. So
I think they would say we were struck down. I think they would tell it. Just, I mean, what would you say to your wife? What would you say to your kids?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it'd
be very hard to hide something like that from anybody.
I suspect that a number of those Roman soldiers became Christians. I mean, how could you go through an experience like that? And a lot of them may have been there at the cross as well. And what did the man at the cross say? Truly, this was the Son of God, right?
Yeah.
And he wasn't the only one who was thinking those kind of thoughts. Well, okay. So now we're looking at the experience of Paul. What is your faith based on compared to Paul? How many times did Paul give an explanation of his faith to other people?
Multitudinous.
Well, anytime he preached, he did that. So
do you think he figured out how to say it in the most convincing way you can possibly imagine?
Yeah.
Okay, what we need to do, we need to have a little session here, okay? Next time we meet here, we'll have Yoli explain to us why she believes what she does, and then Carrie, it'll be your turn. What would we do? What would happen if we did that? Maybe we need to do that in our churches. Take turns and stand up and explain why we believe what we believe.
I don't know. Do you think that might cause some trouble? Because I might explain a little different than you.
I think, yeah. That would be wonderful. I think it would shake things up.
Yeah.
I think some of us would be embarrassed. Others of us would be... I think a lot of us would give phony reasons. And people would say, that just doesn't hold any water. And we would go home and do our homework again. Well, Paul, what were some of the tools that Paul did? He talked about things which were familiar and or as a kind of a stepping stone to things that were unfamiliar. Can you think of some familiar sort of metaphors that Paul used?
The Romans and Greeks were, both nationalities were interested in athletics.
Yes, very much. I mean, look where they...
I hate to go back, but your kind of a challenge you raised there. Remember what it says in Romans 10, yeah. 9 and 10. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, mm-hmm. and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved.
Mm-hmm.
For man believes with his heart, and so is justified, and so he confesses with his lips, and so is saved. And saved meaning healing.
Yeah.
You have your understanding... Mm-hmm. About God straightened out, it's life-giving.
Well, we know that the Olympics, to carry on at Carrie's point, thank you, Jim, they were really big into the Olympics, into sports. The Romans were, especially into foot racing. They had foot races wearing a full complement of Roman military gear. You got to run wearing all that stuff. And they had regular foot races, of course, and they had wrestling matches and so forth. And Paul would use these as stepping stones to try to explain something further. What kind of illustrations do you think he would pick on today? Christianity is like the internet.
It seems so much more dark today, though.
Yeah? Okay. Can you, any other things? Well, I think we need to think about these things. Yeah. Anyway, what can we learn from passages Paul uses illustrations that his readers are familiar with? Let's just pick out a couple. Look at 1 Corinthians 9, 24 to 27. And let's start with verse 23. All this I do, this is 1 Corinthians 9, all this I do for the gospel's sake in order to share in its blessings. Surely you know that many runners take part in a race, but only one of them wins the prize. Run then in such a way as to win the prize. Every athlete in training submits to strict discipline in order to be crowned with a wreath that will not last. But we do it for one that will last forever. I can remember when I climbed Mount Kilimanjaro the first time, many years ago, before it was even a national park. And when you come down, it was wonderful in those days. They would pick in that area. There's these everlasting flowers. I don't know how many of you know, but they dry almost like they were still alive. And they would weave you a wreath out of these everlasting flowers and put it on you. And that was proof that you had reached the top of Mount Kilimanjaro. And I always appreciated the fact. I mean, look, they could have just picked a bunch of green wreath stuck on your head, and you know, 2 days later it would look like, you know. That is why I run, Paul says, straight for the finishing line. That is why I'm like a boxer who does not waste his punches. I harden my body with blows and bring it under complete control to keep myself from being disqualified after having called others to the contest.
That seems pretty relevant today, even.
Doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And we could go on. Well, look at Galatians 5:7. You were doing so well, he says. Who made you stop obeying the truth? How did he persuade you? It was not done by God who calls you and so forth. These are athletic illustrations. Look at 2 Timothy 2, verse 5. An athlete who runs in a race cannot win the prize unless he obeys the rules. What kind of lessons could you learn from that? Well, Christians must run the best race we can. We are running for an eternal prize, not just one that's a fading prize. And everybody can win, not just one person. And from the days of the Roman consul Marius, who ruled over on three different occasions, starting in 107 BC and ending in 86 BC, the Roman government replaced temporary soldiers with full-time career warriors. These were stationed in Roman outposts throughout the empire. People were recruited from all kinds of backgrounds and were accepted if they were willing to totally pledge their loyalty to the ruling emperor. They were given handsome rewards at the end of their terms of service. What could you use out of that story to illustrate Christianity? How many Christians are looking forward to reward, are guaranteed a reward, if they really play by all the rules and do what God asks them to do, right? So, from these passages, Paul concluded that Christians should use the weapons of truth and persuasion. And I guess we should look just briefly at Ephesians 6. You know this expression starting with verse 10. I'll actually start with 12. For we are not fighting against human beings, but against the wicked spiritual forces in the heavenly world, the rulers, authorities, and cosmic powers of this dark age. So put on God's armor now. Then when that evil day comes, you will be able to resist the enemy's attacks, and after fighting to the end, you will still hold your ground. So if we're fighting against the devil and his evil angels, what kind of weapons would we use?
The word, the truth.
The word of God,
mm-hmm.
Scripture, right? We need to have clearly in mind the very best arguments against Satan's deceptions. Well, when he came to the end of his life, and he knew he was about the end of his life, 2 Timothy 4, verse 7, he said, I have done my best in the race. I have run the full distance. I have kept the faith. And you know, some translations have, I fought the good fight. What is Paul trying to suggest there? The original Greek, it turns out, suggests a conflict or a contest of some kind. It uses the word, I've done my best, I've fought a good fight, I've run the race. The word is agon, from which we get agony. He's saying, man, I just stretched every fiber, I did everything. I mean, I was in agony to do what I needed to do. So in what ways today do we struggle in the battle against false ideas and claims? We live in a pretty casual, laid-back society. Do any of us struggle?
Not too hard as a rule.
Not too hard. Well, are we in a contest with the evil forces in our world?
Yes.
Is there ever a time when we're really free to sit back and relax and say, look what I've done? Probably not, right?
When the race is over.
Yeah. Well, you know, in Romans 1, 2, and 3, there's Paul's, well, all the way up to 8, but especially in 1, 2, and 3, there's Paul's basic argument. In Romans 1, he says, you Gentiles used to be a very wicked lot, but if you've turned to God, he will save you. In Romans 2, he says, you snooty Jews used to think you were so much better than Gentiles, but in actual fact, because you were so so snooty, so proud of yourselves, you are worse than those Gentiles. And then he comes to Romans 3 and he says, okay, let's be honest. Every single one of us is a terrible sinner. There's no question about it. And so what do we do about it? What are we supposed to do? Are we supposed to just throw out our Christianity, throw out God's law, throw out everything? No. Romans 3:31 says something very interesting. Does that mean by this faith? Now he says we will conquer by our faith, and that's Romans 3:25 and 26, 27. Does this mean that by this faith we do away with the law? No, not at all. Instead, we uphold the law. Now that sounds like almost a contradiction to what he said before. How does Paul's message uphold the law? If you look at Paul's writings, there's 130 times that he mentions the law. And if you look at reports about Paul's activities in the book of Acts, 20 more times. 150 times when Paul talks about the law. And you know that a lot of Christians today would tell us that Paul has done away with the law. We don't have to worry about it anymore. Does it sound like he's doing away with the law if he talks about 150 times?
You spoke about Christ's crucifixion. Mm-hmm. Many people use that to say, oh, this was nailed at the cross. Paul said this, when in fact it doesn't at all.
And Paul was the one who talks about nailing it to the cross, wasn't he? He's not talking about nailing the Ten Commandments to the cross, by the way. Is it completely clear in your mind which of the laws in the books of Moses are still applicable to us? Or do those Old Testament things are they just completely irrelevant to us anymore? Do we benefit in any way by studying those things?
Sure.
Yes.
How does it benefit us?
Well, I think if you follow history down through the ages, there's always been some version very similar to the Ten Commandments. One way or another, every civilization's got some set of rules.
Yeah.
We humans don't have a very good history of behaving ourselves.
Yeah. We see right through the Old Testament the incredible lengths to which God will go to relate to his children. Absolutely unbelievable. Well, we see in Paul's writings, Romans 3:19, he says, I'm still under the law. But he was also said that he was released from the law, Romans 7:6. He talked about the law of sin, Romans 7:25. And he talked about a law that was holy in Romans 7:12 and 25. He mentioned the law of Moses in 1 Corinthians 9:9. He also talked about the law of God in Romans 7:25. To non-Jews, all these discussions were probably confusing, but to Jewish believers who had grown up with a rabbinic education, they understood what all that meant. So, what was Paul telling us? He's not doing away with the Ten Commandments. He's not doing away with the writings of Moses. He says we need to look at those things, we need to study them, and we need to extract from them the important principles that God has given to know how to live God-fearing lives. By the way, do you think anyone who wanted to start a new government someplace and write a new set of laws for a new government, how many of the Ten Commandments would he want to do away with?
None.
Well, there's a lot of our Christian friends who would like to get rid of the Sabbath commandment.
Yeah.
But I don't think he'd want to get rid of any of the others.
No. Yeah, anarchy.
Yeah. Well, Paul recognized that all the details of the priesthood and the sanctuary services and that kind of stuff, after Jesus dies and that curtain in the temple was ripped from top to bottom, and that thing was, 30 feet high or something like this, you know, and it was a big, heavy curtain. You don't just rip it casually. He recognized that God was trying to say something, wasn't he? And especially after the temple is gone.
It was ripped from top to bottom rather than bottom to top.
Yeah. Yeah. Top to bottom.
Somebody was doing it besides the humans.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, what was Paul thinking about when he said, I made up my mind to forget everything except Jesus Christ and especially his death on the cross? Let me ask some questions while you think about that. would the cross mean anything without the resurrection? What if Jesus had died all the way he died, as far as we know, but he never got out of the grave?
No sense at all.
Would an ordinary,
we wouldn't be here talking about it now.
Yeah. Would an ordinary death followed by a resurrection have meant anything? There were a number of those. In the Old Testament there were some, and Jesus did raise a number of people from the dead. Now we would say, wow, that's great. But it's not the basis of our salvation. So why was the way Christ died and why he died and the way he arose so crucial for the Christian message?
You had to answer the questions that logic would have raised as to how sin works and what's the effect on human nature. You assume that, well, a person dies, well, God must have been angry with him and kills him. No, Jesus showed that even the righteous will person can be affected by sin, even though they were not sinners.
Let me read a couple of paragraphs from Desire of Ages. This is page 753 of Desire of Ages. All his life, now Jesus is, this is 753, I think this is on while he's hanging on the cross. All his life, Christ had been publishing to a fallen world the good news of the Father's mercy and pardoning love. He really believed that, right? Yes. Salvation for the chief of sinners was his theme. He says, I don't care how bad you've been in the past, you just need to come back. But now with the terrible weight of guilt he bears, he cannot see the Father's reconciling face. Now God was right there, but he couldn't see him. The withdrawal of the divine countenance from the Savior in this hour of supreme anguish pierced his heart with a sorrow that can never be fully understood by man. So great was this agony that his physical pain was hardly felt. He was so torn up by the fact that he couldn't communicate with his Father that the nails and the crucifixion and the beatings and the lashings and the crown of thorns really didn't matter to him. Satan, with his fierce temptations, wrung the heart of Jesus. The Savior could not see through the portals of the tomb. Hope did not present to him his coming forth from the grave a conqueror or tell him of the Father's acceptance of the sacrifice. He feared, now this tells us why he died, really. He feared that that sin was so offensive to God that their separation was to be eternal. What was his biggest concern as he died, was dying there on the cross?
That he had been forsaken by his Father.
Christ felt the anguish which the sinner will feel when mercy shall no longer plead for the guilty race. It was a sense of sin bringing the Father's wrath, which is, well, how do we describe Father's wrath?
Separation.
Letting him go. Romans 4:25 would be a... Mm-hmm.
Bringing the Father's wrath upon him as man's substitute that made the cup he drank so bitter and broke the heart of the Son of God.
And the preamble to that was the Garden of Gethsemane.
Yep.
He went through that same experience. He was next to death there.
Okay, now turning to page 785, a few pages later, when the voice of the mighty angel was heard at Christ's tomb saying, "Thy Father calls thee," the Savior came forth from the grave by the life that was in himself. And he said that was what was going to happen, John 10, 17 and 18, and John 2, verse 19. He said that was going to happen. So, let's think about this. Jesus died not just a physical death, he died of sin, and that sin mainly consists of separation from his Father. He was torn away from his separation from his Father. And that's why he died. He was separated from the source of life as a human being. He arose by exercising his divine power and came forth from the grave on his own, in his own strength, in his own power, divine power. What do those two lessons teach us?
First, you have to decide what the difference is.
Okay.
Because
tell me more.
Well, if he could raise on his own power, mm-hmm. doesn't that mean he's still connected to God?
Yes.
So then the first
when it comes time.
When the first statement happened, He wasn't connected to God.
Right.
So
as a he died as a human being. Aspect. He died as a human being. But after he's died, then there's one more thing that needs to be proved. Satan, back in heaven, said, why is Jesus treated different than I am? I am just as good as he is. I stand on one side of the throne, he stands on the other side. And God says, no, there's a difference between you and him, because Jesus is God and you are a created creature. It says, as
so
I,
are we.
And Satan says, yeah. No, Satan says, I don't buy that. I don't believe it. I don't accept it. And God says, okay, the day is coming. I will prove to you that Jesus is God and you're not. So, you want to try it? Go ahead and die and see if you can bring yourself out of the grave.
Well, if you're dead, you don't really care.
Not a question of whether you care.
How do you prove anything when you're dead?
Jesus proved by...
It's going to prove to the people that are still alive, but not to Satan who dies, because he's dead.
But the point is, he proved once and for all that he was not a creature by raising himself from the dead. If you're a creator, if you're God, you can raise yourself from the dead. If you're not God, you can't.
So what?
End of story.
What's the bad thing about getting disconnected from his Father if he already has life in him?
Well, okay, I'm going to bring modern belief into it. Most of our Christian friends believe that when you die, what happens? You go, well, I mean, who in this world's history has lived a better life than Jesus? Nobody, okay? So according to usual Christian teaching, when Jesus died, instantly he's where?
Heaven.
He's in heaven. Why is that a big problem? I mean, he's crying out here, my God, why have you forsaken me? 5 seconds from now, I'm going to be in heaven with you again. What's the big deal? If that's really what goes on.
Well, that isn't what goes on with humans.
Okay.
But
so,
what about the thing that was in him where he rose himself?
Okay.
I mean, how can that be there without being connected to God?
Okay, I'm going to take a couple sentences because we're supposed to be talking about Paul and his gospel here.
That's fine.
But let me just try here really quickly. Jesus had to live his entire life until he's dead in the grave as a human being without exercising any of his divine power. He had that divine power, but even when he performed miracles, it was not through his own power. He performed miracles by cooperating with the Holy Spirit to perform those miracles. Ellen White spells that out very clearly. It's not so obvious in the Bible, but it's very clear from Ellen White. And why is that important? Because he wants to, I mean, if he was always doing things like performing miracles on his own behalf and so forth, what would Satan say? You, Jesus is no human being. He has all these advantages. So he has to live a life which is no different than any human being until he's dead. Once he's dead and once he's proved his point, then he can say, okay, now I will take back my divine power and I will raise myself from the dead, proving that in fact all along I was God.
So when he's in the tomb, his divine side is also...
His divine side is there, but he has the ability to turn it on at any time, even though he's dead as a human being.
He's also known as Almighty God under... Everlasting Father.
Yeah.
It's a piece of the eternal one.
Again, Christ went away and prayed. Now we're coming back to Gethsemane. Again, Christ went away and prayed that if it were possible, this cup might pass from him. His soul was filled with an overpowering fear of separation from God and consequence of sin. That's what he was afraid of. By the way, every time we sin, are we torn apart by being separated from God? We live in sin. We think it's perfectly natural. It's what happens, right?
Well, we're not totally separated from him until we're dead.
Yeah.
So what's your point there?
Well, he didn't want to be separated from his father even a little tiny bit.
Okay.
He was terrified by being separated from, I mean, not just terrified, I mean, he realized the seriousness of it. And we just sail along in our sins and it's no big deal to us. Well, coming back to what our Christian friends believe, what's the truth? Well, 1 Timothy 6:16 says only God has immortality. 1 Thessalonians 4:16 and 17 says immortality then will be a gift from God to the saved. And then 1 Thessalonians 4:13 to 15 and 1 Corinthians 15 verses 6, 18 and 20 say death is just asleep until Christ returns. So as we know, beliefs in almost all religions include many false ideas based on the immortality of the soul. Things like reincarnation, praying to saints, veneration of ancestral spirits, eternally burning hell. Many of the beliefs and practices of the New Age including channeling. This is why a correct understanding of the nature of man and his state in death is absolutely essential to a correct understanding of the gospel. And how good are we at explaining that to our Christian friends? Have you ever tried?
It's almost impossible because they're locked into a paradigm that you can't shake them out of.
Depends on the situation.
Mm-hmm.
I've done that once or twice. Once fairly recently, somebody who lost a mother.
Mm-hmm.
And for somebody who's had very little religious training, probably with Sunday school, never really gave it any thought until this happened. Well, she's in heaven, and then I thought, no, it's not what the Bible says. Christ called it asleep. And there will be a resurrection day. Judgment Day and all, and simply explained it, and okay, well, I never really heard that, but it makes sense.
Yeah.
No sense going to heaven if you've got to turn around and come back when Christ comes to the world. It's not logical.
The wicked dead are asleep, along with the righteous dead, I might add.
And if the righteous dead went to heaven, let's say a parent up there, and they're observing, and they see their kids having trouble. Wouldn't that be a type of hell for their parent, for those parents? You can't do anything about it.
Yeah.
When I was very, very small, and I would hit my brother or do something, I'd try to hide under something.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I didn't want God to see me do it. I'd call him and...
Well, there's no way that the loving God, the gracious God that we believe in, could operate an eternally burning hell.
No.
I mean, this is just can't be.
Well, it's all based upon that serpent's lie in Genesis 3.
The most merciful thing he can do for people who don't want him anyway is just to say, I'm sorry, back away.
You know, that makes so much sense, but then why does it seem so hard for the world to grasp that?
Why was it so hard for the disciples to believe that Jesus was going to die when he got to Jerusalem? Because it's contrary to what they've always been taught and always believed.
And he never explained what the efficacy of his death was going to be.
Well, at least we don't have it recorded.
Well, and it seems to me it's pretty important.
Yeah.
And then we get to Romans 3:25, but Paul trying to explain it, and probably 90% of the English Bibles mess it up.
Yeah.
I have a hard time accepting it myself sometimes, because I'm thinking if somebody has a disease and you're sick, and you know if you take this antibiotic, you're going to feel better. Why would anybody refuse it, you know, unless something is wrong? And I don't understand why, you know, the person who refuses it, something is wrong. Something is inherently wrong.
Here's what, let me, as a physician, maybe I can help you understand that. There's two different kinds of medicine. One medicine is sugar-coated, but it's a poison. And the other medicine is bitter, but it's salvation. And the devil is selling the sugar-coated poison as fast as he can. People say, why should I take the time to study the Bible? Why should I believe that stuff? It's much more comfortable to watch movies and you know, do all the things that everybody else does, go to the ball game. Why should I bother with trying to find out about all this Christian stuff?
Or perhaps they spend their time in escapisms with amusements and so forth, or they'll take a drug or something that numbs their mind, whether it be alcohol or something to smoke or whatever. It's just because they don't want to wrestle with the issues. It just somebody offers them something quick and easy, escape.
So with all these distractions, how can we today go give that mission to the people around us?
That's our challenge.
What about the 70 disciples he sent out?
Mm-hmm.
Go out, spread. They don't listen. Dust your shoes off. Go to the next town. You're not going to convince everybody. And we're the ones that are given the mission. Mm-hmm. It's been down through history. It isn't. God doesn't come down and stick a steering wheel in people.
Yeah. So you're telling Ollie that the cure is just it's hidden to some people because you've got all this other stuff going around.
Yeah. Well, we need to talk about a few more things in the last few minutes we've got here. Paul was a very forceful person. He had a very strong personality. Yet he found it possible to work with a lot of associates. A number of them are mentioned by name. Acts 13:2, Acts 15:22 and 37, 16:1-3, 19:22, Colossians 4:7, 10 and 11, so Philemon 24. Can you mention maybe five or six different people that Paul worked with at different times that he mentions by name? Well, just name some.
Cornelius?
No. The ones that Paul worked with specifically now.
Barnabas
in his first missionary journey.
Silas.
Silas, second and third missionary journeys.
Timothy. Luke.
Exactly. Yeah.
One more.
Can you think of another one?
James.
Peter.
What about Peter? Oh, Peter he did. Yeah. What about the couple?
Oh, yes. The tent makers.
Yeah.
I couldn't think of their names, but I know who you mean.
Well, later on, he worked with Aristarchus. He worked with so many people, and lots of them. There were 24 more people mentioned in Romans 16. But not everything was always smooth between Paul and his co-laborers. And we know about the story of Barnabas, don't we? What happened? Barnabas had a cousin by the name of John Mark, a young man who said, it seemed like an exciting thing to go with Paul and Barnabas on this missionary journey, on this second missionary journey. And what happened? Oh, actually, his first missionary journey. What happened? He got to Pamphylia and he said, boy, this isn't as easy as I thought it was going to be. This is tough going. He went back home, right? And so the next time when Paul and Barnabas were getting ready to go out on the next missionary journey, what happened? Barnabas says, let's give the young man another trial. And Paul says, nothing doing. That
took the hard line.
Slacker. But later on, Paul took a very different attitude toward Mark, right? Remember 2 Timothy, when you bring, it's here, verse 11, 2 Timothy 4:11, only Luke is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you because he can help me in the work. I sent Tychicus to Ephesus and so forth, Joaz, etc. Lots of names. Why do you think it is that these short documents from Paul, there's none of them that are very long, have had probably more influence on the world than any other document in Greek literature? When the Jews in Macedonia were determined to capture Paul and kill him, he escaped by fleeing to Athens. There he met with the intelligentsia of the city and gave them a very convincing sermon, parts of which are recorded in Acts 17. Do you find it difficult to speak to associates, friends, or casual contacts about the truth, especially truths which are in contradiction to the common beliefs of the Christians, of other Christians? Well, Paul said that Jews wanted what? Miracles or signs. What's a sign?
It says stop or yield. Or
Well, let me.
Something that's going to point to something in the future. Yeah.
Okay. How is it different from a miracle?
Miracles can't be explained.
Okay. Are miracles good evidence to prove the correctness of something you believe?
Depends.
If you watch the channels on TV on Sunday morning, what do you see people doing?
Dancing.
It looks like they're performing miracles, doesn't it? And what's their response? Okay, because I can perform miracles, that's proof that I'm speaking for God, and you must believe all the nonsense I'm teaching you, right?
And send in your fire insurance premium.
Yeah, and send in your premium, right.
Cold offerings.
Yes.
Avoid the fires of hell.
But that's not new. There's people used to do that way back then.
Oh, yeah, exactly. Yeah. There's nothing new about it.
A little paper for their
What position is what part is logic supposed to play in our evaluation of religious claims?
Hopefully a lot.
There are some people that really have no... They denigrate the idea of using logic. They think you should operate from the emotional standpoint to think of some other people.
Can you think of a passage where Ellen White talks about using logic or using sense, talking about the teachings of... I'll just read it for you. I know you can't read it. God never asks us to believe without giving sufficient evidence upon which to base our faith. His existence, his character, the truthfulness of his word are all established by testimony that appeals to our reason, and this testimony is abundant. Does that sound like logic?
Logic that is infused or comes from the source of logic and the source of truth, which is God, not man's logic.
Mm-hmm. So how's the best way for us to start a conversation with even a fellow Christian to try to talk about some of these issues?
You have to adjust to the situation in hand.
Yeah. Two or three things. First of all, you're probably not going to get very far with them if you hardly know them. You have to become friends with them. Yeah. You have to become friends with it, maybe workers, associates, or whatever like that. Probably. That would be some kind of a relationship you have to have with them. And then you have to be willing to speak up. Paul apparently struggled with knowing how to relate to people of different backgrounds. How are we supposed to know which way God wants us to use with any given individual with whom we may come in contact? Those are tough questions, aren't they? I struggle with it all the time. I deal with multitudes of people at the clinic all the time. And people come in and they're dying of cancer and things like this, and you wonder, you know, is it appropriate to say to them something about the state of the dead and God? I mean, these are tough questions. Traditionally, Adventists have used evangelistic meetings, individual Bible studies, printed lessons, you know, the famous printed lessons. Is it time for us to think outside the box and think of new ways to try to reach out to our fellow Christians and, even to non-Christians? Can we be like Paul, doing everything possible to win some? We find that talking about biblical subjects is a stumbling block in 2015. This is an example, a relatively modern example. There's some famous Adventist pioneers by the name of Fernando and Anna Stahl. And they went with some printed material to South America. They were going to open up the work on the Amazon. So they started going from door to door, trying to sell people these printed stuff. And what did they find?
They couldn't read it.
Nobody could read. Very few people could read. So what did they say? Well, this is not going to work. What did they do? They opened up clinics. They started churches. They started schools. They even opened up markets. And suddenly they transformed the lives of literally hundreds and thousands of local Indians there. One of the remarkable metaphors that Paul used in describing the Christian community is in its similarities to a human body. So none of us can pretend like we're everything to everybody. Some of us are ears, some of us are eyes, some of us are feet, some of us are hands, some of us are whatever, hearts. Paul talks about that. But the Christian church, if we pull together and we help each other, we can reach out. Many Adventist churches today have focused on trying to make the church environment more user-friendly. Mm-hmm. That's a great idea. But maybe the time has come for us to not just make the church a user-friendly, but to reach out into the community to help them see, these Adventists are great people, can't we do something that will help them to realize it? That we're doing a great thing. We need to be out there in the community. Ellen White said, God's workmen must labor to be many-sided people. That is, to have a breadth of character, not to be a one-idea people. Stereotyped in one manner of working, getting into a groove and unable to see and sense that their words and their advocacy of truth must vary with the class of people they are among and the circumstances that they have to meet. Be very careful, she goes on to say, not to present the truth in such a way as to rouse prejudice or to close the door of the heart to the truth. So, what are we supposed to do? Try to imagine what Paul would have done if he were alive today. What would he do if he came to your church? Your church. What do you think Paul would do in your town where you live, in your environment, in your setting? What would Paul do? Well, take an example. Sit down with your friends and say, okay, you're the Adventist, and here's a group of young intellectual, university students, let's say, from the world. What would you say to them? Take a group of professionals, young professionals, or some people like that, and try to explain why Jesus had to die. We need some practice. We need to try some of those things. And each one of us will do it in a little different way. Edna's not going to do it the way I do it. Yoli's not going to do it the way Carrie does it. Each one of us needs to learn how to do it our way. And it's your turn, too. How would you do it? Can you explain our teachings in a way that's meaningful to someone you meet? Our kind and wonderful Father, once again, we thank you for the truths that are presented in these scriptures. A lot of very challenging ideas, thought-provoking ideas. May we gather what we can and find ways to implement them in our lives is our prayer in Jesus' name. Thank you.